This is Palm Sunday. Palm Sunday tells us that every story has a beginning, but this is not the beginning of the Jesus story. This is the beginning of the last chapter of the Jesus story. Now, some people have said it's crazy for Unitarians to celebrate Easter. For us, Jesus is man, not God. But I say this is our story also. It's crazy not to dig in deeply into this. It's harder, perhaps, but it's important. So today in the story, in the world over, is looking in the Christian church, is looking at Palm Sunday, the entry of Jesus into Jerusalem in his last week of life, so to speak. Jesus enters into Jerusalem. All expectations are upon him that he will come and replace the royal occupation. His followers are expecting a great reset in the empire of Israel. That the Romans somehow will bow down to his rule and get up and leave Israel and go back to Rome. This is like Luke Skywalker walking onto the Death Star and Darth Vader bowing down and handing Luke the keys to. That's the kind of story this is for the Christians. The hopes and the dreams of the followers are upon him. A ministry that they have pinned their lives to face a violent and brutal occupier. So the story says he came into town with fanfare. But the ending isn't so simple. So to contrast Jesus' entry into Jerusalem, I want to put it in a little bit of context. Mary Beard, who's a Roman scholar, wrote a book on the truth and legend of Roman triumphant entries. You might know that every Roman victory, military victory, was then followed by a parade of sorts back into the city by the ruler or the emperor. So Caesar would march into Rome with his troops. Mary Beard describes it like this: a great procession sets off from the field of Mars. That's the field of war. The grassy meadow around which the Tiber makes a great arc. Roman citizen army return from yet another victorious campaign. Parades through the streets of the city. The soldiers follow an ancient route flanked by temples dedicated to previous victories. Through the great circus, on into the forum, until to catcalls and fanfares and leading a barbarian king and great pile of treasure, they escort their general up to the temple of Jupiter on the Capitol. Impassively, he stands in his chariot, a wreath held over his head. He wears the clothes of God. Contrast with the Jesus story. When they had come near Jerusalem and had reached Bethpage, the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately you will find a donkey and a colt tied with her. Untie them and bring them to me." The disciples went and did as Jesus directed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and put their cloaks on them, and he sat upon them. A very large crowd spread their coats on the road, and others cut branches from trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead followed, shouting, "Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest heaven." When he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was in turmoil, asking, "Who is this?" The crowds are saying, "This is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth in Galilee." Notice first the Unitarian expression of this interpretation. He comes in the name of the Lord. He doesn't come as the Lord. And he comes as prophet Jesus. So interpretation is everything. Depends on who you're talking to. But notice on the other hand, the contrast with Caesar. Now the writers of the Jesus story, whether it happened like this or not, knew the Roman situation. They knew that Caesar entered triumphantly from a victory with prisoners and treasure on a chariot. And when they wrote the story, they put Jesus on a donkey, with his followers placing dirty coats and palms underneath him as a sign of respect. What are the writers trying to tell us? The Romans, on the one hand, with fanfare, stage with armies and treasure and the shimmer of promise of the future, and the followers of Jesus, on the other hand, with a humble servant sitting on a donkey, dirty coats on the ground. Imagine the modern day scenario like this for a minute. Imagine and indulge me in a bit of fantasy. But instead of presidential parades going through Washington, D.C. in limos and followed by military helicopters and mounted police, you know, the symbolism is not lost on our government in connection with the ancient Romans. But imagine instead Beyonce coming in for her 46th inauguration as a 46th president, riding on a bicycle all alone. A guy can fantasize about these things. It would send a different message. The message for those who heard the biblical story understood the difference. They understood that Jesus was coming to be a kind of different leader. A kingdom that was softer and built on humility and love rather than on might. The legend actually says of Caesar that on his chariot, a slave would stand behind Caesar, whispering over and over in his ear, "Remember, you are mortal." The triumphant parades, though, were extraordinary opportunities for self-publicity that solidified Caesar's godly status, whether he believed the slave or not. And anyone who heard of the Roman victories would be terrified. In this context, this Jesus story is told. It was not lost on the writers. And that's what we have. A story of a simple teacher coming into Jerusalem the week before the Easter story. You know it's not going to end very well in the middle of the week. But our task is to make sense of this. So, first off, we might admit that, before we go any further in this sermon, that none of us will probably end up riding into Jerusalem on a donkey or even a chariot. We probably will not ever, any of us, be hailed as victors or even expected to do great things. The closest, I think, comes to our own experience of arriving in fanfare and then dealing with the letdown of reality might be arriving for Thanksgiving dinner at our family's homes. That is when most of us going to the door of the family home start out with good intentions. We may be hailed as joyous participants at the front door, and then it all goes downhill from there. Remember, this story is not about triumph per se. It's downhill from Palm Sunday, branches and Hosanna. The high point for Jesus on this day is walking through the door, victor for a moment, but it devolves. Like Thanksgiving, people regress. Politics is avoided. Things get difficult. For me, I was trying to think of my own version of this story of being hailed with high expectations and then leaving in a different way. And I remember being a 22-year-old. I took two groups for two summers with the YMCA to China. And there we met with youth and YMCA dignitaries. And I remember each time we would arrive at a new town, there would be parades of young children playing instruments and violins and drums and horns and big lines of people, and we'd all walk through, me, this 22-year-old, and 8, 12, 14-year-old Americans. And I would prepare a great speech to speak to the people. Apparently, I didn't know that they didn't listen to speeches. They had been listening to speeches of communist leaders for 50 years. And so as I started, they just started talking to one another. I lashed out in my American way and told them that when someone speaks in America, people listen. My translator looked at me rather timidly. I have no idea what he said to the people. But I know the feeling a little bit of entering in victory and celebration and leaving in despair. That is the story today. So why does it exist for us? Perhaps for the early Christians, there was a personal note. Many of them were seen as deserters of their origins, or worse, cult followers. The question on how to deal with rejection warns of being a hero one minute and fallen the next. Early Christians would know biblical stories about that. And more personally, they will have known the loss of love and confidence from people they knew, they loved and knew. It asks us today, have you ever been an outcast, an outsider, and how did it feel? Was it lonely? Did you feel abandoned, without hope? To feel alone among others or cast out is the start of something, either a downward spiral into further despair or a journey to find one's community. More than one person here has walked into this church and felt abandoned by the people they love and found a home here. It's no accident. It happens in religious communities. The gift of the early Christian community included secret initiations and a format for behaving with those who pushed you away. It called the early Christians to turn a sense of abandonment into love and forgiveness. We've been working on that ever since. Of course, this has been distorted like so many other early Christian intentions. I have heard this story from those of you from evangelical families, that once you told them you were visiting this church, they closed their doors to you. I've heard this story of gay and lesbian and transgender and questioning members of this church, that once you expressed a thought of your own sexuality or identity, you were cast out. I have met too many who knew rejection. And the good news is that those who found that rejection didn't end in rejection. They looked for community. They looked for meaning making. So this story might be a parable. It's asking us a personal question. It's asking us, in what ways have we been received like a king or queen one day and rejected like a thief the next, with only the reason that we were being true to ourselves? And then it asks, how do we meet such rejection with grace? That's the personal. The story has so many other implications. It is also a parable about crowds, how crowds can be powerful and dangerous. When Pilate in this story asks, what do we do with this guy Jesus who calls himself king, in the most haunting line in all of the Bible, the crowd shouts out, crucify him. At my church in Boston, we used to put on a reader's play of the Palm Sunday story on this day, with all the characters played by different members of the church. The first year I was there, I recruited a 13-year-old girl to play Jesus, to the dismay and murmuring of the power brokers of the church. You can imagine power brokers of a Boston church. She was actually great and now is in Hollywood and I take all the credit. But when we came to the moment when Pilate asked the crowd, or in that case, the church, what do we do with Jesus? And the whole church yells out, "Crucify him." I looked at my little 13-year-old who cowered before the eyes of the sea of angry faces while Pilate, played by a city transportation engineer, made the pronouncement from the governor's pew to take him away. My skin crawled. The power and the danger of crowds, like the poet wrote, can carry an enmity like no other. We saw this at political rallies just this past year, with protesters being egged on to beat, supporters of the current president being egged on to beat protesters. We know that whoosh that passes through crowds, it gets us moving, and sometimes it's used for ill and sometimes it's used for good. I think the reason that crowds can get dangerous is not the feeling of unity, but the feeling of isolation. That sense that if I don't join in, I will be on the outside. That 12-year-old brain kicks in moments like that, and I know because I live with a 12-year-old. The antidote is to try to bring others closer, to find our own voices, to make thoughtful decisions in the crowds we are in. And sometimes crowds are necessary to move things. This week I was in Austin lobbying our representatives to defend, not defund, Planned Parenthood, reminding them that money taken away for political purposes is in fact an attack on the poorest women of our state. And a young college student from an American Indian background stood before the crowd of 1,600 pink-clad concerned citizens and quoted Elie Wiesel saying, "Neutrality helps the oppressor, never the victim. Silence encourages the tormentor, never the tormented. Sometimes we must interfere when human lives are endangered, when human dignity is in jeopardy, national borders and sensitivities become irrelevant. Whether men and women are persecuted because of their race, religion, or political views, that place must, at that moment, become the center of the universe." As I listened to her and as I stood in the offices of our representatives this week in Austin and the previous week in Washington, D.C., I found myself feeling like a man sitting on a donkey walking into the empire. I spoke to our representatives in Austin and in D.C. as a person of faith, reminding them of their religion. They were Christians and some of them were Jews. And I said to them, "You are called to leadership not to forget the poor, the vulnerable." I reminded them that removing Planned Parenthood from Medicaid means 11,000 Texas women who make less than $13,000 a year for a family of four will lose, in most cases, their primary health care professionals. I reminded them that removing money for contraceptive and STI tests affects the poor disproportionately. I felt the great irony of being clergy in those offices of power, trying to reset hearts of politicians who I felt may have forgotten who they are deep down and what their religion calls them to be. For the Christians, their leader, this Jesus character, leads with an olive branch and dines with prostitutes and lepers and heals the sick and feeds the poor and rides into a holy city on a donkey, not a chariot or a limousine. I think the ancient Christians were trying to do the same with the people of power of their time. They were trying to reset the hearts of religious people who knew that God of Psalms, who wiped away enemies with the right hand and the light of his countenance was upon them, and trying to replace that concept with a meek leader who talked about love, who came in the name of something softer, something more compassionate, but something powerful. I was reading the Tao Te Ching, and that same ancient wisdom is there as it is in this story about Palm Sunday. It says in the 78th chapter, "Under heaven, nothing is more soft and yielding than water. Yet for attacking the solid and strong, nothing is better. It has no equal. The weak can overcome the strong. The supple can overcome the stiff. Under heaven, everyone knows this, yet no one puts it into practice. Therefore, the sage says, he who takes upon himself the humiliation of the people is fit to rule them. He who takes upon himself the country's disasters deserves to be king of the universe. The truth often seems paradoxical." An ancient Chinese saying sounds like Christianity's story of Jesus coming into Jerusalem. In our story today, the teacher is welcomed and then rejected. The crowd calls for his death. No beauty emerged, only violence occurred. I wonder if this story is asking us to lead our lives in more humble, loving ways. I wonder if we can rewrite part of our human culture and ask whether something soft is also powerful. Can we contemplate our gifts and our place in the world and find ways to contribute to the salvation of all without joining a crowd that says, "Crucify him," and raises the sword? It starts with us asking, wondering again if humility and love will ever triumph over power. It asks us, will we turn our own abandonment, our own disappointment, our own failure and isolation and loss into violence? Or will we turn it into love for others? We are at the threshold of this story. There is so much more richness to talk about, but today is only about a man who came into Jerusalem on a donkey. Is the beginning of the end of the story. There are some palms here if you want one to remind you of today. The story points to the cross, to a deep dive into the dark reality that truth might die. And it's done today in church to prepare us for the joy of Easter. So I hope you join us Thursday where we tell the full story. It is the key to all of this, but I hope that you remember that today's story asks each of us, if we lead with humility and love, is it stronger than might and power? It asks us who we will be in the crowd. Will we be those cheering to crucify? Or will we know a deeper meaning in our lives for our world's sake? I leave you hanging on the edge of that story. The Holy Week begins. Amen.